Here a piece from the Sefer Ahavas Meisharim, Kanachi 2. This is written by the Mashgiach of the Lamja Yeshiva, and I have the special distinction of having the same name as Moshe Rosenstein, and he's known as the Lamja Mashgiach, Mashgiach of the Yeshiva of Lamja. So he has a very interesting piece that he has a very interesting piece here. On a topic that we just, you know, was introducing, is very pertinent to a lot of people when they're coming home from school, and that is from seminary, or anybody who's growing, any Baal Tshuva, any person who grows in their Avodas Hashem. So you end up in situations sometimes where your growth and your Avodah, what you're needing to do for yourself, comes in conflict with other people, right? And what's best for me and my ruchnias and my spirituality and my connection with Hashem, you know, it can end up being something that is upsetting to somebody else. And this is a very, very difficult ma'avar to go through. It's a very difficult passage for a person to go through. And, it causes a lot of internal conflict. It's something that he has a very interesting perspective on, and I want to go through it. I hope we'll have time to go through the whole piece. It's a number of pages. But, we'll just go through it, and we'll be discussing what he says along the way. And, I guess we'll have it. So, right, we have time, right? You have another test today? No, the test is okay. So, relax. Okay. So, Memzayin.
That's
is terrible. You can leave
it's
if you
funny.
Want
to. It's funny.
Okay. Simin Memzayin. Simin Memzayin. The Perek Memzayin 47 in the Sefer Ahavas Meisharim. I told you there's a picture of him here in the Sefer. It's a picture of him.
Wait, is this the book by
Moshe Rosenstein? That's his picture. You can see his picture over there. It's
Moshe
Rosenstein.
The
very
shocking.
There's no relationship. I'm saying no relationship. But he's a big tzaddik, a big Baal Musar. Regarding the pain, the tzar, the discomfort, the frustration, the difficulty that comes to other people through my avoda. Okay, dvar ata be'ezus Hashem inyan rav ha'erech yo'el la'odom liskun inyanov levaliyat mederech ha'yesharah. I'm going to now deal with a topic that's very, very important that can prevent a person from swaying off the proper derech. Please pay attention, my beloved readers, to these words that I'm saying right now. He's asking us to tune in. Natchil min hakatan v'nashlim hagadol. We're going to start from small and then we'll finish with big. Rabbeinu hagadol zal amar. Halo divrei harash b'sefer orchos chaim. He's quoting now the Rosh. The Rosh was Rabbeinu Asher. You know who that is from classes? Yeah, Rabbeinu Asher, the father of the Tur.
Wasn't it the Rif and the Rosh that are the commentaries on the Shulchan Aruch?
On the Gemara. No. The Shulchan Aruch used as the basis for his halacha was the Rif, the Rambam, and the Rosh. So the Rosh wrote a Musar Sefer called Orchos Chaim. That's the name of the Sefer. There's some places that the Minog, I used to learn in Yeshiva in America, a few places that I was, that the Minog to read this whole Sefer every day of, I don't know if it's all of Elul or Aseres Mitzvah. It's like a little Musar Sefer with lots of different pieces of Musar and advice. Okay, so he says like this, that the words of the Rosh in the Orchos Chaim, Shalos Sosrim Zeh, there's a stira, there's a contradiction in the Sefer. Ksav, he writes in one place, Al tase davar sheyilu guabrios, shadarcham lahali matobos ful galos aros. Don't do things that people are going to make fun of. Don't do things that people are going to mock and have an issue with. Why? Because it's the derech of people, right? It says over here before Shakespeare, lahavdil, what did Shakespeare say? Well, he's talking about after a person
Which
is
one?
Dead. But what did he say? Yeah, about Julius Caesar. He says that the evil that men do lives after them. The good is often interred with their bones.
Yes.
And that people think about the bad a lot more than the good. That's just the teva of people. People are negative in general, right? We work on ourselves to be more positive. But the teva of people is to not pay attention. Right? It's called negativity bias, right? A small negative thing turns you off completely from the whole thing, right? It's like, I'll just think about this. How come one hair on a plate of pasta and a person will be turned off from eating the whole plate of pasta? I mean, that's kind of strange, right? Everything else is totally fine. It's one thing,
but it's not.
It's just the way that a person feels. Yeah, so that's what he says. So when we do things that people, you don't give people the chance, the opportunity to find fault in what you're doing. So don't do things in front of their people. But on the other hand, because of Ode, but he writes elsewhere, Al taniach derech hasidus. Don't leave ways of piety, ways of doing things right. Even though they're making fun of you, don't be ashamed to do mitzvos. Don't be embarrassed when you need to do a mitzvah. So the Chora Sosim says that it seems to be that there's a contradiction. So it seems to be the, on the one hand he says, if people make fun of you, don't do it. On the other hand he says, don't stop just because people are making fun of you. So which is it, right? So he says like this. V'amar Shekeinu Pesher Dvarov. Emrotza Adam Lasos Eza Dover Asher Hutov Be'enov. Avel Eno Iker Midache Hanhagaso. Okay, now this is giving us like a psak. He's giving us like a way of understanding this, okay? If a person wants to do something that to him is good, it's good for them to do it. It's something that's positive for them. Okay? Aval eino ikur midarche hanagaso, but it's not something that is like central to who they are and what they are as a Jew and as a person. Hinei aniach ze laval yachshel acherim bilagom al maaseu. That type of thing you should not do in front of other people. Let's just give an example. I don't know if Baruch Hashem, every person who's working on their own things and whatever. So I'm just going to give an example that I'm assuming nobody here is working on. Let's say Mayim Achronim, right? Let's say somebody wants to take on, Mayim Achronim. Okay, well, I would hope most of us have many other things to work on before we get to that. But let's say a person wants to work on Mayim Achronim, right? Now, is Mayim Achronim something central? Because Mayim Achronim is at the end of a meal, there's an Indian like this. In the olden days, there used to be salt, like a type of salt called Melach Sedomis. Which was dangerous to a person, and just like we wash for bread before we eat, there was a halacha that before you bench you have to wash your hands, called mayim achronim. But already in the Gemara there's a discussion in Tosfos, and we've shown him whether or not this applies today, and the Shulchan Aruch brings down two opinions, and there are many people who do it, many people do it, and many people don't do it, different minhagim and different practices, and either way it's fine, there's no brach on it, and you don't need a kos, or they're just washing your hands. That's the halacha of mayim achronim, meaning the water at the end. That's halacha. So let's say somebody wants to take this on, or somebody wants to take on washing metilas yadayim for vegetables and fruits that are have liquid on them. Okay, so these are nice things to do. Very nice to do. These are things mentioned in Shulchan Aruch as things that a person can do. A person wants to take on that they're not going to eat granola except in a bread meal. Because there's a question about what the bracha achron is and granola. All these things that you can learn over the course of your year. Right? Now, you have to ask yourself, is this something that is like central to my avodas Hashem? Is this something that's central to who I am and my connection with Hashem and my connection to Torah and Judaism? Is this a halacha psuka, something that I have to do? If the answer to that question is no, it's something that I like to do, it's something that's nice for me to do, it's something I get something out of, but it's not something that is like central to who I am. So he says, in that case, I should drop it if there are people that are going to make fun of me. And if I'm sitting at a meal of people, and if I would get up and wash my machronim, it would be something that people would think is funny, and whatever, drop it, love it. There's enough poskim that say that you don't have to do it. So if you, okay, that's what he says. The aval imu echad bedarchei hamhagaso vhu etzlo dover ikri. But if on the other hand, it is something that's very central to me. Let's say there's a girl who's worked on SNEAS over the course of the year, and she's upgraded her sensitivities in terms of how she presents herself and how she dresses. And she goes home, and this is not where her mother is holding, not where her parents are holding, and her mother's upset at the way she's dressing. Her mother wants her to dress in it's very hot outside, looks so uncomfortable. And the mother says it's embarrassing to her. Who knows? People have all sorts of things. All these things. So she says, it's upsetting. Well, it's upsetting to me. Or you have a situation, unfortunately, a lot of times the situations of, somebody is invited to some sort of an affair or an event where, it's going to be halachic issues about being there, usually, an intermarriage or all sorts of things that you can have, situations of, potential issues and family issues if I get involved or not. So he says, if this is something that is, central to me, something that is important to me, this is a halacha, something that, so then the person, you can't stop just because people are going to be upset. It's about this that the Tana writes in Pirkei Avos. You have to be brazen, like a leopard, who hunts out into the open like that. Okay, that's what he says. Okay, so I'll pause here for a second. Okay, so he just says, this is the idea, right? He gives us a very straightforward psak, so to speak, that a person has to know the thing that I'm taking on and that I'm doing, what type of thing is it? Is it something that's central to me, or this is just something that I appreciate and I gain from and I grow out of, but it's not something that is a part of my core of Avodas Hashem, and that determines whether I do it in front of other people who are gonna have issue with it or not. Now we're getting to a topic that is something that is extremely valuable to understand in the way that we conduct ourselves. Right? We all know, at this point we all know that it's central to our avodas Hashem, central to what we're supposed to be doing, is to do whatever we can to never ever cause any sort of pain or agmas nefesh, distress to anybody, to anything that I do, And how much more so to our immediate family members, right? These are people that have all sorts of other mitzvahs that don't even apply to other Jews. And if I'm not allowed to pain to other Jews, how much more so? Of course, these are people I'm not allowed to cause any pain to. The Ishto, Levarov, his wife, his children. That these are people that, that how much more so a person has to be so careful not to do things that are going to cause them pain and Agmas Nefesh, right? And yet we see, right, that those are the people that are most affected by our religious growth, right? Our immediate family members, the people who are with us all the time, right? You have a husband and wife that are not so religious, and then one of them, starts becoming more religious and strengthening in religion, and it causes friction, potentially it can cause friction, right? A person in these types of situations, we're in the second paragraph, or the second big paragraph now. Yeah, a person can find himself in a huge dilemma, a mevucha, right? It's right over there, mevucha. Oh, it's embarrassed, okay, also a dilemma. Im yavo liyodo eza maisa asher yirat zelasos l'shem shemayim. They have the opportunity to do something l'shem shemayim, right? Something comes their way, an aspect of growth, they hear an inspiring class or something, they do what they want to grow. V'hu be'inov davar tov v'roi lasos. They see this as something good and appropriate to do. Right? Somebody wants to, close down their Facebook account. They're thinking about it. This, all they want to just close it down. Aval yigrom zetzar v'agmas nefesh l'krovov. Right, but this is going to cause pain and distress to my relatives. Afle elu shemuzer al kavodam k'mula avivimo. Even to those that I am required to be extra careful about, like a person's parents. Hine yavo ha'adam b'mavucha shelo yada hilasos maseu hatov v'bazov v'mdeyatzar migiel l'krovov. A person reaches this place where he doesn't know what to do. On the one hand, he feels this is very important for him to do, but on the other hand, he doesn't want to cause tzar, he doesn't want to cause pain and upset to other people. I'll tell you again, where this comes up is, sometimes if there's a relative that that intermarries, the halacha is in general, a person that have a shiloh, they just posing. The circumstances, the halacha is under normal circumstances, a person is not allowed to eat at the wedding of any non-Jew, whether they're marrying a Jew or not a non-Jew. It's a halacha actually that they learn from a pasuk. In the Torah, that even if a person attends a wedding of a non-Jew, like two non-Jew, you're not allowed to eat at a wedding. That's a separate halacha. It's like a gezeira and chaka, a chalta mizivcho, that we may come to eat from. From other things. Anyway, that's halacha. So sometimes a person has a situation that they're invited to a wedding, where it's a family wedding, a family member that's getting married, and it's going to cause all sorts of friction and all sorts of problems. And if they don't go, and people say it's tearing apart the family, and a person feels awful. Again, I'm saying a person should ask a shayla on a case by case basis, speak it over with the rabbi, whatever, find out what it is. But let's say after all is said and done, the person gets a tzak, no, you may not attend this wedding, you can't go. And the person realizes as a result of this, nobody understands this, they don't understand, people are very open-minded, they just don't get it, they don't understand, they don't have the same values, and it causes all sorts of akmas nefesh to those people who I'm closest with, that I have the highest level of responsibility, and I don't know what to do, I don't know if I should do it or not. Asher be'neim ram ma'aseu, should I do this, if it's going to upset these people so much? So again, we have to think about what the Rosh said over here. Emu ach davar tov levad, enu ikri mi'ikri hanagaso, v'kumuvan she'enu mitzvah mechuyeves, k'hu tefillin v'tzitzis. Now he's saying again, if it's something that is either a straight up halacha, right, we cannot break halachos to make other people happy. Again, is it really breaking a halacha? You have to ask a shayla on a case-by-case basis. Like we've spoken about all sorts of cases this year, under circumstances, for shalom bayis, all sorts of things, posting a rav knows when is it appropriate to be lenient and when a person can't be lenient. So you have to be able to have a kesher with somebody to ask these shaylas when they come up. But let's say you ask all the questions and you get all the things. I'll give you another example. Over the years, just some questions that came up. There was an event on Shabbos, like a graduation. event that was taking place on Shabbos for a sibling of somebody. It involved all sorts of things that, let's say, you know, certainly if it involved Chilul Shabbos outright, if it involved actually breaking Shabbos, so there's no question that, you know, there's nothing to do, no matter how upset people would be. But this is a question, it wasn't even like, you know, breaking Shabbos, there's all sorts of things, like going places and, you know, paying in advance, and, you know, all sorts of things, which again, a person needs to speak out these things, you know, with a competent posek and you know, Rav, and a person who knows, you know, how to deal with these types of situations. But after all is said and done, the person gets back, and the answer is no. This is against halacha. You cannot do it. There's no room here. There's no place to be lenient. There's no second opinion. There's nothing else. This is the way it is. Yeah. Or if this is something Lamashal is followed the Kol Rav. He gives an example here of the other type, right? Not something that a person has to do. Again, like I'm saying, he's saying here, if it's not halacha and it's not something that's part of my core being as a Jew, Lamashal, for example, what I give examples of my machronim saying here to daven out loud. Yeah, let's say that, you know, for a person, let's say they got into benching this year and say brachos, so they want to bench out loud now. Say every word of benching out loud. Yeah, but it disturbs other people at the table, right? It's good for me. It helps my kavana. I noticed that over the course of this year, I worked on it so much. I bench much better when I bench out loud. It's not something you have to be doing. If this is not something that is central to your core being a Jew, so then you drop this. If it's upsetting to other people, certainly to your parents, okay? So no benching out loud at the Shabbos table if it bothers other people. That's what he's saying. That's not a halacha that you're mechuyav to do. I would assume for most of us that's not something that we would consider part of our ikur being as a Jew, the fact that I need to bench out loud. So don't do it. Don't bench out loud to upset other people. But if a person has a certain derech, a certain practice that they do, but that for them it is something that is vitally important for them, in terms of their avoda, asher yosim alav tikvas tovos l'tikun nafsho v'la'giyam ezelamaylus gedolos. Yeah, the person feels that by doing this is going to help me grow. This is for me, you know, a stepping stone that's going to help me, you know, get to the next level. Let's say, you know, a person wants to, attend a particular shiur series or something like that. Okay, from a person's feeling, you know, down, which happens. Yeah, a person's feeling down, not so motivated, and they hear there's a certain, you know, rav coming, a certain person, a woman, whoever, coming, giving a certain number of classes in the town, and they feel, oh wow, you know what, this is really what I need. And I remember that person was so inspiring to me in the past. I really feel this is, like, you know, the thing I need. Yeah, but going there is going to upset. You know, there's some other thing that, not that I made a commitment that I can't break, whatever. But there's some other thing that people are going to be very upset that if I'm going to choose the shiur and I'm not going to go to this, right? But I really feel this is something for me that this is very, very important. Again, a person has to know. You should, again, speak it out with somebody to make sure you're not having negios and being biased, right? But we're saying if a person has discussed it, they realize this is something that's very, very central to me. And this is where I'm placing this is part of my path to growth, part of my path to becoming a better Jew is down this road, on this derech. And I can't drop this, right? And again, certainly if it's something that is halacha, right? That a person can't break halacha, can't break Gilgal Shabbos, can't break kashrus, etc., in order to make other people happy. And now I'm in the situation. But through doing this, like keeping this halacha, yeah, or by keeping, even if it's not a halacha, even if it's an extra thing, but for me, this is something that, again, you have to be very honest with yourself. I would be very, very, very wary before paskening for myself anything that wasn't a halacha, that this is something that's like an ikr to me. You know what I mean? I would be very careful and speak it out with anybody before you cause sa'agas nefesh to somebody else, because very often, you know, what we maybe think is in our best interest, maybe for ulterior motives of wanting to look for them or wanting to meet that expectation that people have for us when we get back from seminary, etc., etc. So I'm just saying, for our purposes, I'm focusing this piece much more on halacha and keeping halacha than on his emphasis, which is on like higher levels. You know what I'm saying? So for us, I would say basically anything that you're doing, unless, again, you speak it out with somebody and then somebody says it's absolutely the right thing to do, etc. But short of that, I would only apply this to halacha. Let's at least start with that. You know what I mean? That's what we're talking about here. This is going to cause tremendous pain, even to my parents. And the person, he doesn't know what to do. He loves his parents, but oh, he loves them very much. Right? We're not even talking here about he's asking a shayla of kibud av-aim. You know, I mean, sometimes girls come in and they say, oh, you know, I have a kibud av-aim shayla. You know, halacha. That's not even talking about. It's about a person who doesn't want to do it. They don't want. They want to be able to break the halacha here because they don't want to hurt their parents, right? And not that they're asking from a halachic standpoint. You know, is it against kibud av-aim? You know, for me to not go to this wedding or whatever it is. I how can I do this to my parents? You know what I'm saying? You know, okay. A person enters into a big dilemma. As again, a person realizes he can't drop this. And for us, I'm saying, like, you know, breaking halacha. So a person can lose out a tremendous amount from breaking this thing. Even in this case, he says, "Shelo yaniach b'shum ofen, don't drop it." As darachu b'chasidus u'avodus Hashem b'nei atzara megiel misibosol aviv v'imo v'shar b'nei mishpachto. Don't drop it. Don't drop it. If it doesn't, you know, it's going to address this tzar soon. And how could it be that I'm allowed to cause this tzar? Is it also for me to cause tzar to my parents? And how could it be that keeping? And again, he's even applying it to, you know, when you have a real halacha. So then that halacha is clear, right? If a parent tells a child to break a halacha, the Gemara tells us, you've heard this line before, divrei harav, v'divrei hatalmid, divrei mi shomin, right? If the Rebbe says something, the teacher says something, and the student says something, so who do you listen to? You listen to the teacher, right? So the teacher is Hashem, and Hashem says, don't break Shabbos. And the student is the parent. The parent says, yes, break Shabbos, so we listen to Hashem. There's no question about it that we don't break halacha because our parents tell us to. The point, he's even applying this thing, you know, to the things that are beyond halacha. But again, he's saying, you know, how do we deal with this? How do we deal with the pain that we're causing to other people? Hine kasavnu psak halacha. So I want to explain to you, I've written here a psak halacha, that you may not drop these things, you may not do it. Aval netakes eitza eich yikare rucho v'shever libo atov mehatzar ha-migil akrova v'shera ohev osam kenafsho. But I want to try to explain to you something here, to lessen, to cool off your spirit and the broken heart, the hashever libo atov, that, you know, a person's good-hearted, does not want to hurt other people. How can it be? How can it be for doing this mitzvah? I'm supposed to hurt another person. So I want to try to calm you down and explain to you, how this is okay. So now I want to explain, how is it okay that we're allowed to do this and cause this pain to other people? So that it should be easier for us to do this, easier for us to go ahead and do things that we need to do, even if it's upsetting to others. Should we continue? Should we continue with this another day or now? Should we continue now? Do you want to do it another time?
No.
Now? I'll buy you that. Okay. Yesh la'adam l'das. A person needs to know. Ki im yavin b'dayto, sh'ader chasidus ha'shu barcha chayav tuliyim bo, hine lo yanichas darcha, v'lo yichav libo mu'umma me'atzar ha'godol me'gil akrovam me'sibaso, ebnei sh'yesh lo la'adam. He has to understand the following. Okay, and now he's shifting gears completely. He's shifting gears to a completely different track of understanding, you know, how the world works and how I do things that affect other people, etc. What's my role? And listen to what he says. Now he shifts into bitachon. Now we're just talking about my belief and accepting that Hashem runs the world. Shu eno rashoi lachon ligrom lehem tzar v'agmas nefesh. Right? He's not allowed to go ahead and cause them agmas nefesh. Aval im umuchrach mipas atzvo lasos davar. Umeze yavo lehem eze tzar. Lo yasin libo klal ozel aniach mateze ezdarko v'yede v'yamin. This is the point, right? You shouldn't stop, and he has to know the following. Ki barur v'nochon hu ki hatzair ha-megiyah lehem misibaso hu muchrach lehem migzeiraso shel ha-mokom baruch hu. This pain that is coming to this person, this parent, this cousin, this whoever it is, the tzar, the frustration, the fights, the upset, the tears, the anger, all of these things, these are all yesurim, these are tzar, this is pain in this world, this is yesurim, right? All of the suffering that this person goes through, yeah, I have to believe that this is min hashamayim. Ein lo hayacholus lahatzilim mehatzar hazeh. There is nothing I could have done or could do to save this person from this tzar. This is what it means to believe in Hashem. This is what it means to believe that Hashem is running the world, right? When I believe that it's not me. It's not me who's doing good things, yeah? And it's also not really me who's doing bad things. Yeah, again, obviously it is that a person's accountable and we have to keep halacha. Yeah, but when keeping the halacha is what's causing tzar to somebody else, I have to believe be'emuna shalema that this tzar is coming to this person from Hashem. And if that's the case, that this is something that this person, for whatever reason, they quote unquote deserve this, whether deserve it to pay them back for something, or deserve it because they need it to grow, or deserve it because they need it to, for them to get to the next step in life, whatever that means, yeah, there is nothing that I can do to change that. And if I were to not do my mitzvah on account of their tzar, Hashem would find their tzar another way. There's nothing that I'm doing that is adding an ounce of pain to the pain that they need to get anyway. It's coming through me, yes, and he's going to address that further in a second. But step number one is to believe and understand there is nothing I can do to stop this tzar from coming to this person. This is from Shemayim. Ein lo hayecholus latzilim latzar hazeh. V'yamin ba'od she'mipnei rachos libo shlo yuchol lizbol tzaram. I have to believe strong that if because of the softness of my heart that I can't handle the pain that they're in, yaniach avodaso v'darchum b'chassidus asheinu r'shoi lasso zos, and I drop what I'm doing even though I'm not allowed to. Again, I break halacha. It's too much for me to see, this family member so upset that I'm wearing longer sleeves. I just, okay, whatever. I'm just going to go out today. When next time I hang out with her, I just can't handle it anymore. I'm just going to wear short sleeves, yeah, so that she doesn't get so upset. It's that whatever it is. Yeah, that's a hine yamin al nachon ki lo yoil luhem huma. You have not helped them at all. You have not done anything. Right? By doing an Avera, you're not saving anybody pain. Right? This is what we learned when we on Shabbos, the whole thing about Tzaraas, so cutting off the Tzaraas. There's a lot to cut it off, because if Hashem put it there, there's a reason that it's there. And doing an Avera to try to avoid pain doesn't work. Ki im kasher uroa nigzor aleihem es tzar v'achmas nefesh yagi alehem. Yeah, when a person sees v'liyasa lehem shum tova ba'azo b'zarcho, it's not going to help them at all for me to stop what I'm doing. It may look like it. Today, they're all going to be, finally she gave up that idiocy. If they still had another 30 points of pain, again, to either pay back or because they needed it to get them somewhere else, whatever, they're going to get it somewhere else, right? My Avera is not going to bring them any satisfaction, rest. Kim kasher ro hu ro en nigzer alev a starbag letter on him, he ne lo yuchol ahit the tzilom zeh, nothing I can do to save them. Bahar be sivos yesh nam lahavi lemes, the erosav shom lakum marahu. Hashem's got many, many ways that he can bring about this same exact level of pain and discomfort, etc., etc. He can bring it about in many, many other ways. It doesn't need me to do this. Vine tov lahem, she is belu tzar me'avodas Hashem. And now he's taking it to the next level. Not only this, not only is there nothing I can do to stop them from having this pain, and even if I would stop doing what I'm doing, it's not going to affect the tzar that is due to them on any level. But not only that, it's better for them to suffer this way through somebody's avodas Hashem, and not through who knows what, getting robbed. Right? Let's say a person has, 40 points of Akmas Nefesh that they need to get in this week, however Hashem works, you know what I mean? Well, 40 points of Akmas Nefesh. Now that could happen through a car accident, it could happen in Chas V'Shalom, getting robbed, Chas V'Shalom, something bad happening at work, or it could happen that their crazy daughter comes home from seminary and, all of a sudden is, wearing long skirts. Right? Those are the four paths that Hashem has to bring a person tzar this week, yeah? Tov lahem she is blue tzar me'avodas Hashem asher hu oved masher sheyavo lahem dvarim metalim. It's a better form of pain. It's interesting what he writes. It's like a holier form of yisurim for them, even though they don't know it and they don't care or realize. We should know that this is the best type of yisurim for them to get. Frustration coming through avodas Hashem gives them a connection to that of avodas Hashem. Yeah, masher sheyavo lahem dvarim ki ata yesh lahem tikva tova ki tzarim amagila mederach haTorah. So beautiful what he's saying. They're being moser nefesh for the Torah. They don't even realize it. They don't even realize it, right? But they're suffering for the Torah. They're suffering for halacha. Yeah, that's the best way to suffer. This we all know. I mean, some, I don't know. The best way for a person to get yisurim in this world is Yisurim that are done through the doing of the mitzvah, where a person's embarrassed with all these types of things. If a person has to suffer, it's the best way to suffer in Kedusha, right? Suffer through the Torah, there to be most nefesh for the Torah. Again, there's nothing we can do to avoid this. We can't obviate the pain that's coming. Yeah, so it's better for a person to be suffering through Ruchnias. Achariso tia tova gadol alahem. It's going to be very good for them. It's amazing what he writes. Ki chen bevada imachayev sechleinu shekavot shemayim dorish zos shemash asof macherim avadosi yizbaruch yilehem la'achris tova. Right? It's going to be in the end good for them. This, the pain that they're suffering is literally being moser nefesh for Torah, even though they don't mean to be doing it. But now, what's going to happen? I'm going to do the opposite. I'm going to drop my. I'm going to break the halacha. Yeah, I'm going to do what they want me to do in order to make peace and to calm everybody down. It's unbelievable. So we're failing now twice. Number one is I'm doing this aveira. I'm doing this wrong. That my life depends on this. The second thing is I'm not helping them at all. They're going to have that car accident, you're going to have that robbery, you're going to have that demotion in work, or who knows what. It's going to happen, right? But now it's going to happen in a lower way, right? In a lower way. And I've been the one to cause that. My avera, in trying to make peace, is actually making it worse for the people that I'm trying to help. That's what they're saying. You hear how much emunah a person has to have to go with this? The imamish have to believe this. The imamish have to believe that everything is min hashamayim. Hashem is doing everything. When it comes to finances, a person can't affect another person. It looks that way, everything looks that way, etc., etc. But there's no way to avoid this. And if this tzar is coming to them, the best way for them to get it is this way. Now, but again, I just want to make this point. I'm going to make it over and over. You cannot do this without asking a shayla. You cannot do this. You don't know enough Torah to know when this is the appropriate way to be and when you're supposed to be flexible. That's why you need a rav, a posek, somebody that you have to ask questions to about this topic. Because if you don't, and you just take it on yourself to, you know, be strict in certain areas and you cause pain to somebody else. So again, if you had no choice, and so then, you know, that is maybe what it's talking about. But if you could have asked somebody and you didn't, then, you know, that's a form of negligence on your part. And then, you know, it really is that you should have been flexible. So then I don't know how much credit you get. I don't know, Hashem knows how it works, you know. But there's not such a thing as a person who had a good kavana, you know. But you have to be very careful. I'm just saying practically, you should never do this and just say, oh, it's okay for me to hurt my parents or whoever, without making sure that there is no other way to do it. Because there's another way to do it, so then you absolutely are not allowed to be the one to cause them pain, even if there is no other way. Okay, fine. Okay, this is like the story by Rabbi Akiva and Papos. We'll stop over here. Let's see if it's... and then the rest of it, he brings in different proofs to this. He brings in proofs from Yosef, that how Yosef really caused tzar to Yaakov Avinu. All those years that Yosef was hiding in Mitzrayim, so to speak, and all these, you know, he really could have told Yaakov what was going on. But he didn't, because he knew that there was a bigger plan that had to play out over here. That's the idea what he brings. But anyway, let's skip out maybe to the very last paragraph. Okay, so I've explained to you a very fundamental point, and I hope it's tremendously fundamental. Anyway, that's the idea. I think it's a very important point.
Thank you. Can I ask you a couple of questions?